Welcome back, everyone, to Implementing a Data Warehouse with SQL Server 2012 Jumpstart. I'm George Squillaci. Notice SQL is in the name, and I'm here with Rich Curry. Rich, you like to cook, and curry's in your name.
It's a spicy combination, I will tell you that.
So what's up for this module, Rich? Our final segment of the day.
Yep, and this one kind of deviates a little bit from what we've been talking about right along. However, it is completely appropriate in this discussion because it's talking about enterprise data. Now, enterprise data, as you are well aware, George, is the lifeblood of a company. So what we're going to be talking about in this module is two relatively new pieces to SQL Server: master data services and data quality services. Now, master data services first came in with SQL Server 2008. We were going to give you an overview of what it's all about, talk about the data models and entities and attributes, hierarchies, business rules.
Lots of moving parts.
Yeah, there are lots of moving parts. So, master data services is the SQL Server solution that was developed to manage enterprise-level data. Now, we talked about, and I had a slide up way back at the beginning of this today, that talked about the fact that data needs to be matched from different systems. We have lots of operational systems that consume the same data. And it is a really good idea to have a single source, because let's face it, if I'm a customer in an organization and I'm a customer of, say, three different subsidiaries of that company, that means that I might have registered as a customer three separate times. Maybe I used Rich Curry one time, Richard Curry one time, and R. Curry one time. Mm-hmm. Each of those is me, but because I put my name in differently, the systems think I'm three different people. So master data services allows me to create a single source for the information that's used by multiple solutions within the enterprise. It allows an organization to do centralized storage of data rather than distributed storage. It allows us to create a single spot for a data steward to go to clean things up.
A data steward.
We talked about him earlier today. And we also now have a single spot for ETL to go to take and get all of that information distributed to the systems that need to consume it. Now, master data services uses data models and business rules to not just define, but also manage the correctness or validity of the data. Now, a data model is a container, George.
All right.
It is a container that has entities in it. Now, an entity is a real world thing. The data in a data model represents all of the entities. So, for example, a product could be an entity. A customer could be an entity. A supplier could be an entity. A shipper. All of those entities have attributes. Attributes are the pieces of information that describe them. Just like in a dimension, George, a dimension has attributes that are used to describe the entities there. So I create entities, I create attributes. Then I have the ability to create hierarchies. Hierarchies express the relationships between entities. Now, you might be tempted to create one big data model. Nah, don't do that. Create smaller data models that are purposed to a specific part of the business. Don't try and do one size fits all. Do different pieces that are purposed specifically to the part of the information that they're covering.
So I have to create a data model, and I want to compartmentalize using some sort of rule book.
Yep. I may have, for example, a customer's data model, a product's data model, a supplier's data model. Each one is going to have all of the entities, all of the hierarchies, all of the business rules necessary to validate what is going on with the data.
An honest question here, Rich. So if I have multiple systems that might have product data, I might create a products model. If I had multiple systems that had customer data, I might create a customer model.
Absolutely. And it doesn't even have to be multiple systems. You can create a data model to control the information in a single system.
There you go.
With the thought that there might be more systems coming later.
Aha. Uh-huh. So set it up ahead of time.
Absolutely. You know, plan to succeed.
All right.
And then you will succeed when you plan.
All right.
Anyway. So a data model contains both entities and attributes. The entity represents a business object, a logical business object, like a customer, like a supplier, like a product, that can be consumed in one or more systems. And each entity has multiple attributes, the pieces of information that describe that entity. It might be for a customer, first name, last name, address, email, city, region, postal code. There could be a bunch of them. And then the collection, each entity has members. You could be a customer. I could be a customer. Danny could be a customer. Even Elise could be a customer.
Woo!
You know, the peanut gallery likes it when they get included in the broadcast, so I had to do it.
There you go.
Now, each of those members has to have values assigned for each of the attributes that represent that entity. Now, when you're designing it, George, each entity is typically going to map to tables in RDBMSs, and the attributes are going to map to the columns. So if I've got five different systems that each use product data, I'm going to create a product entity, and I want to make sure that I define an attribute for every column that exists in every table. It doesn't mean that I'm going to have the product name five times. I'm going to make sure that I have an attribute for name and it appears in all five systems, so I have a single source for that attribute value.
Master data.
You got it. And then the members will map to the individual records in each table. Now, next step is relationships between those entities. And typically, that's going to be the same thing as setting up foreign key relationships. The analogy holds true. It is a parent-child relationship. Hierarchies represent either the relationship between entities themselves or between individual members of entities. And that kind of falls into the difference between a derived hierarchy and an explicit hierarchy. A derived hierarchy is one that is determined by the relationship between entities. You can look at it and say, hey, guess what? This category relates to these products. There is a way to derive the relationship. It's based on attribute values. An explicit hierarchy is one that you're putting together. For example, maybe I have continents like North America and Europe, and I've got countries to map to it, but I don't necessarily have a continent in my databases. I don't have an attribute called continent that it would make sense to build. So what I do is I create what's called a consolidated member, and I give it a name, such as what you see here on the slide, with the consolidated member code CUST-US, consolidated member CUST-EU. Now, when you've got explicit hierarchies, you also have the ability to specify whether they are mandatory hierarchies or whether they are not. A mandatory hierarchy is one where all members of that entity must be assigned to one of the consolidated members. If it is non-mandatory, then they don't need to be. So, for example, If all I wanted for a consolidated member, George, was my U.S. and my European customers and the rest of the world, I was going to let them go and just say, you know, they're not a part of the U.S. or European customer groups. That would be a non-mandatory hierarchy. If I then created a consolidated member called All Others, where my U.S. customers were in one, my European in another, and then everybody else was assigned to All Other, I could then make that a mandatory hierarchy.
And you have some things to show us now.
I do. We are going to drop over to our virtual machine now, and the first thing we're going to do is, I got to tell you, George.
What's that?
You're not going to find Master Data Services in SQL Server Management Studio.
Different management tool?
It is. And it's one of our favorite ones. Internet Explorer.
Browser-based admin.
You got it. It means no installing tools on the desktop. And there are advantages to that, although not necessarily a lot of them. I'm going to set my browser to point to the installed instance, and you're going to configure this when you install Master Data Services on your network. I'm going to localhost port 81/MDS, and that brings up the home page for Master Data Services.
There you go.
Let me get it scrolled over so you can actually see the whole thing. Now, the first thing that I want to do is I want to go into system administration because I have not yet created a model. So I am going to create a model. Notice I'm in my add model. I'm going to call that model customers.
Just for a sec, can you slide your VM title bar over a little to the right? It looks like that's being clipped at the left.
It's not.
It's not? Okay.
No. Nope.
All right.
Yeah, I'm fully all the way over.
Okay.
Let's
there
see.
There you go. Perfect.
Okay.
That's it.
Yeah, screen looks like it's getting clipped there. Sorry about that, folks. So what I'm going to do now is I'm not going to create an entity at this point because I'm going to go and do that at a later point. When I save it, my model is now in there with the name of customers. It shows up with metadata. I'm next going to go to manage and choose entities. First thing I need to do is choose the correct model. So I'm in model. And now I add an entity. The entity I'm going to put in there is customers. I can assign a staging table for that entity. I can create code values. I can enable explicit hierarchies and connections. That's what you do here. My choice here, I am going to not enable them. I add my entity in by saving it. And now I have my customers. And notice over here, my entities.
There you go.
Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to head back over. And I need to now add in hierarchy. I need to add in attributes. So, back to system, manage, I clicked too quick, sorry about that. Manage entities, I choose my customer entity, and notice I now get a new set of buttons up here. As I choose that, one of my buttons is to edit the selected entity. And when I do, now I get my leaf members. Another word for attributes. So,
and I don't know about you, Rich, but I think it's going to take people that are new to this to get a little. It's going to take some time to get used to the user interface.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. This is one of those things where practice is going to make you better and better. Now, I know George brought that up because I searched for a moment there because I went back to the homepage and I didn't need to because honestly, I forgot where it was for a second.
Actually, that's not why. I'm not contradicting. I found that I had to wrestle with it a lot.
Oh, yeah. I wrestled with it all the time. Yeah. And sometimes I still wrestle with that interface. So now that I've got my entity set up, I've got my leaf members displaying, I'm going to add in a new leaf attribute. I give it a name. Now, because it's a customer, guess what? We can put in a city. And that is going to be text with a length of, we'll say 400. And when I'm done, I hit save. It brings me back. I can add in another leaf. On this one, maybe I'll do phone. And on phone, I'm going to do a data type of text with a length of, call it 20 characters. I save it. And what do you say we do one more, George?
Let's do one more.
All right. I'm going to put in credit limit. Credit limit is going to be a number that's going to be 0 decibels. And now I choose my input mask, which tells me how I'm going to represent negative values. Now, I'm just going to choose a minus sign here. I save it. And now I have a list of columns for my table.
Have your attributes.
Attributes for my entities. Cool?
Cool.
All right.
We're underway.
We are. So what's next on our journey?
Next up, business rules.
Because let's face it, master data is nothing if it isn't correct. The biggest myth in IT, my data's clean. You want to hear a story, George?
I would. And you have a bunch of good ones.
I do, but I've got one in particular that I want to do here because I did a project back in my professional days for a multinational, well-known, very large corporation with lots of subsidiaries, and it was a business intelligence project that was going to do business analysis to do projections for future business, forecasting. It was about a 14-month project. We spent the first 2 months of the project working on the design of the hierarchies and the dimensions. I say that because it is probably one of the most critical points. We then spent the next 7 months trying to take data from all of these different systems and get it so that it all correlated and was usable. There were mismatches, there was bad information, there was no cleansing done. So we had to do all of the analysis of the data itself and build the cleansing. Master data would have been a huge help to make that happen, to create that centralized spot that we could have then driven everything out to. Just to give you an idea of how complex the cleansing was, the project lasted for about 5 more months, and we did 6 rollouts of functionality in the 5 months compared to 7 months of doing nothing but data cleansing. So that's the level of effort that Master Data Services will provide.
Fabulous.
So going back to the slide for a minute, we are going to be talking about the business rules because they're what ensures that data is valid and correct. Now, valid is one thing. Validation happens at many levels in a database and an application. Correct, however, is something else entirely because correct has meaning. It has substance behind it about determining whether a value is the appropriate value for the entity being tracked. Now, you set up the business rules in MDS, and then you can use either the MDS web interface or, you're gonna love this, for our data stewards who maybe are not as technically inclined as some of us IT folks, you can also use Microsoft Excel as a front-end plugin.
A new plugin that came with 2012.
It is. So let's go take a look at a business rule real quick. We are going to bounce back into our virtual machine and we are going to go back to our models. I'm going to choose my customer's model and now I take it back. I'm going to go back to entities. My apologies. And when I choose the customer entity, I now have my business rules. So in my business rules, this is where I'm going to drive what the validation policy is for specific records. So I create a new business rule. This business rule is going to be check valid. Typing is a challenge at times when you have fingers as big as mine. Valid credit limit. Okay. I've now named it and I go into expression. And in the expression, I'm now going to define what it is I want to do. So I edit my selected business rule.
There you go.
Now, this is not exactly the most intuitive thing you've ever seen, is it?
That is, that's well stated, Rich.
Okay, so there's a couple of pieces here. The if qualifies when I'm going to look at a particular entity. So I can say, if this is true, then apply the rule. If it's not true, then don't apply the rule. In here, I'm going to grab an action, and my action is going to be must be greater than. I'm going to drop that under my actions. Now, I have no condition, so then everything must be greater than. If I wanted to grab, for example, is equal to, I could say if, for example, customer type equals X, then must be greater than. And then down here, I choose my attribute value that I want in there. So the first thing I need to do is grab the attribute that I want. It is the credit limit. I drop it onto my attribute. The value must be greater than, come on there. Oh, I'm sorry, I put that in the wrong spot.
Exactly what I was talking about.
Yep, this is where it gets funky. So now I got to start all over again because I had to delete it. It's not easy to get it, so I'm going to drop the must be greater than. I'm going to drop my credit limit into select attribute this time.
Before you drop, though, look at right where you're going to let go, it says select attribute, and then below and to the right, it says the same thing, but they don't do the same thing.
Absolutely correct, and that's why I got it messed up the first time, because what I'm trying to do is say that the credit limit must be greater than, so it reads top to bottom. And now I'm going to assign a specific value and say credit limit must be greater than 500. I save it. My business rule is now in place. And you can see credit limit must be greater than 500. It is unconditional. Cool, George?
Cool.
All right. So now let's go back. And very quickly, what we want to do now is we're going to go back to our home page. And now we're going to go to Explorer, because Explorer is where we can actually manually enter some data. Now, there's two ways to populate a model. You can use standard ETL, because it's tables in a database. So you just take data from point A to point B. Or, if you've got some specific ones, I can add a member. Now, I clicked on Add Member. It brings all the details over here. And I can say, Rich, the city I am currently in, yep, I can spell, huh? There we go, that's better. A phone and a credit limit. I got a credit limit of 5,000. I'm a good customer. I'm going to say that this is an original entry. I hit OK. Code value cannot be blank. I'll put in a code value of 1.
Good object lesson there.
Oh, yeah. And now Rich is in there, a code of one, Seattle. I'm going to go back in. I'm now going to change this from 5,000 to 500 and hit OK.
Still valid.
Still valid. If I change it down to 50. Still valid. That shouldn't have worked.
Nope, that should not have worked.
All right, so I guess we got a little troubleshooting to do. Ah, what did I not do? I did not apply the rules. So let's see what happens. Business rules will be applied, yes. I think what I forgot is to deploy the rules. So let's go back. Let's go back to our system admin, because you know what I didn't do? I think once I got to my business rules, I did not save it. So manage entities, manage business rules. Yep, I did not publish.
There you go.
You gotta remember to publish the rule, George. Now that I've published it, we're gonna go back. Notice the status is now active. When we come back through here, we're gonna go to Explorer. Notice I have a member in here. See the question?
Well, what do you know?
It's waiting for reevaluation. So now if I apply the rule, I've got an exclamation next to it. It tells me that validation failed.
That's right.
If I come over, notice the validation errors. If I now change this to 501 and hit OK, it immediately evaluates and gives me a green check.
Good tour.
It is. It's a very, very, very cool tool. There's a lot more that you can do with it. Trust me, George. There is a ton of stuff.
Now, what about those circumstances where I don't feel like manually entering in all of those entities into the master data services form there? Is there any way we can improve our efficiency?
Yeah, absolutely. Just a little bit. I mean, let's face it. Most times you're going to have lots of business systems already in place when you're implementing MDS. So consuming master data is all about setting up hooks between all of your systems. You've got a hub and spoke architecture. You've got the master data services as the central hub of your solution, and it then goes out to all of the different systems, all of the different databases, and using SSIS can now manage the movement of the data from enterprise out to operational, from operational back into the enterprise with MDS. You can do your validation and cleansing. You can use that cleansed data then to update the operational systems. Cool?
Very cool. So we have another part of having trustworthy and cleansed data, and what's up next?
Data quality services is the next part of this enterprise data solution. And data quality services is, again, relatively new to SQL Server. It is available in 2008 and 2012. We're going to show you how to build a solution, how to access reference data or talk about reference data. We're going to talk about data validation using DQS and show you a little bit with SSIS.
And I do want to give a test-taking tip, and that is, if you're planning on passing the certification exam, you're going to want to have some hands-on time with both MDS and DQS.
Yeah.
You can download trial versions of the software to help you get there.
And I agree with George. It's one of those that I would highly, highly recommend that you go out and play with it. It's out there. It's good. Well, like we've been talking right along, data is the lifeblood of an organization. Incorrect data leads to incorrect analysis, which leads to incorrect decision-making, which leads to, for many businesses, bankruptcy. So really and truly, it is in our best interests to make sure that that data is accurate and correct. Data quality services implements the tools that do that for us. It gives us access to a knowledge base. A knowledge base can contain information that's used to validate our organizational data, not as a source of our organizational data. And that's the big difference between MDS and DQS. MDS is the source of enterprise information. DQS allows us to correct that information and make it good. We have what are called reference data services that provide that ability to access data. Now, the first thing you need to do when you're creating a solution is to create a knowledge base. The knowledge base provides access to specific areas of information. A knowledge base can have multiple pieces of information. It can have a single piece of information. And inside of that knowledge base, you create domains. Domains house the rules that are applied, the way that you can correct data. So once you've got your domain, which is the responsibility of data, you define the rules that are going to relate to whether a value is correct or incorrect, valid or invalid, and you can even set up matching rules, George, to fix all those typos that happen.
There you go.
I know I can't type to save my life, so if I'm typing wholesaler, I may get W-H-I-L instead of O-L because it hit the wrong key. So matching policies allow me to take values and figure out how they go together. We ready?
We're ready.
All right. Let's see what we can do with this one.
So in the same way MDS requires some base object setup, DQS is going to require some base object setup as well.
It is. Now, unlike MDS, DQS is a client tool. The DQS client is accessible from the SQL Server group of tools in the Start menu.
Start menu access.
Here is data quality services. Here is my data quality client that gives me access. Now, the first thing you need to do, George, is connect to the server that's got all the information, which in this case is Miami-SQL BI.
There you go.
Now, I just want to show you something really quick. I'm going to go into, I hate it when it does that. I am going to go into Management Studio, and I'm going to display databases.
Oh, I see something there.
DQS main, DQS projects, DQS data. There's an MDS database. So I am going to tell you, it ain't free. It's never free. But it is well worth the price of admission. So the first thing I need to do in this process is to create a knowledge base. So my knowledge base, I am going to create a DQS demo knowledge base. And I am going to create it from an existing knowledge base called DQS data. Now, it shows me the domains that are available. So I need to go to next in the wizard because I'm going to do domain management. It now brings me to the next page, which is where I am going to select the domains that I want in my database. Notice there's a bunch of them listed.
Yeah, it's nice the product comes with a one knowledge base that you can work with, and it's some address-related data.
It is. So the first thing I need to do is I am going to be focusing in on the U.S. state domain. Now, that means I want to get rid of all these others. So you highlight it, you click the X, you say yes.
And I don't think there's a trick for multi-selecting that I found.
Unfortunately, George, you better hope you don't have 300 domains and you only want 10 of them. Because you got to do this for every domain that you don't want to use. So while I'm clicking and waiting, we need to keep talking so these folks don't get bored out of their mind watching me get rid of the extraneous information.
All right, while you're mentioning that, here's one rule of thumb that helped me divide between where MDS helps and where DQS helps. In fact, with DQS, you want to think of having correct column values. Whereas with MDS, and again, this is broad, big picture, And with MDS, you want to make sure that you have correct rows when you might have different rows from different systems. I can have different rows from different systems that are all valid. They have correct data, but one, I want to be the winning row, the master. So for whatever that's worth, let's go back to the demo.
You got it. And that's actually a great piece of advice, George.
I think I got it from somewhere else.
Yeah, well, hey, you remembered it. That's a good thing.
Yeah, all right.
All right. So I'm going to change the domain name here from US state to just state. I've gotten rid of all the others. And now what I want to do is go over to domain values, because guess what? There are already some pre-populated values in there. So you can see the state name, and you can see some pretty common occurrences that might show up. AL is correct, but we're going to correct it to Alabama. ALA period is not a correct value. It's an error value, but it's still going to be corrected to Alabama.
So if I see ALA show up in my data, I can set up a rule that says force it into becoming Alabama.
That is exactly correct. So this is just an example of some of the things you've got. I'm going to finish her off now. When I finish building the knowledge base, then it asks me if I want to publish it. For now, I'm going to say no. We're going to hold off on that, okay?
Sounds good.
All
and
right.
How would an IT person, a BI developer like myself, possibly know what typically invalid values will be?
Well, you're going to have some business knowledge, number one. But number two, there are out in the Azure marketplace, there are publicly available databases that you can bring into data quality services as a source of information. Some of those are subscription cost. Some of them are subscription free of charge. It depends, but they are available out there. Many of them are public domain and freely available. Others, you might need to contact a representative to get it. But that's called reference data. All of that is referred to as reference data, and that's what you set up as the source that you're going to use to get some of this information. So if I need a listing of all the cities in every country in the world, yeah, that would be kind of tough to type in, don't you think?
Yeah, you don't have that in your back pocket already.
Nope. So nicely enough, there is probably a database out there. I don't know for sure. But there is probably a database out there that lists every country, its valid abbreviations, every city as well with valid spellings. Now, when you're going in and setting up these projects, you need to do data validation, and that's called a data cleansing project. A data cleansing project is what gives our data stewards the ability to analyze data in a database and manage the validity and correctness of it. So you've got a knowledge base and you've got a data source. The knowledge base we just talked about, the reference data. The data source is the data that I want to check. Cleansing can include validation, making sure values are correct. It can also include matching, finding records that actually mean the same thing. And it can do both at the same time. Now, here's the nice thing. It is not assumed that just because DQS says it's right means it's right. It does output, as a result of the cleansing process, the records that have been affected as well as what the effects were, showing you original values and corrected values.
Some great intelligence that it provides there.
Absolutely, George. So let's go take a look at a data cleansing project and what it does. So in my virtual machine, what I need to do now is access a new data quality project. So just like before, I need to give it a name. In my name, I'm going to just call this, really inventive here, cleanse project. It's late. I can't think of any good names anymore, George.
That's a great name.
The knowledge base that I'm going to use is DQS data. Now, it's a wizard. I choose my cleansing project. I say, next.
Next.
And we wait.
You said say next.
I said I say next. So be quiet. Oh, Lord. So now I've got my data source. My data source here is going to be an Excel file. So I just happen to have out here, George, at the tip of my fingers, a stores.xls spreadsheet, which contains a bunch of information. Now, what I need to do now is map things in. I've got a city. The city is going to map to, and I don't have city in here. So I think what I'll do is I'm going to add a column mapping. Okay, I'm going to... Oh, I'm sorry. What am I doing here? I am going to validate the state.
There you go.
Been a long day, hasn't it?
Long day.
And I'm going to map it to the U.S. state. So my source column, my domain. Now I go in and I go to the next step in the process, which is the analysis of the two. I run my analysis. It takes the inputs. And it uploads in and it processes. As it processes, it's going through, it cleanses the records, and it's showing me statistics about those cleanses. So how many were correct, how many were incorrect, etc. Now this one is running for a while here.
Curious.
It is, because it typically runs much quicker than this.
What do we have, 11 whole rows in the stores spreadsheet, I think?
Yeah.
Whatever, not a whole lot. And there you go.
Okay, yeah, we got pre-processing done.
Pre-processing done.
And there we go. Now we got our cleansing done. And it shows you there were 9 correct records. There were 2 corrected records. When I go to the next step, I can see suggesteds, new, invalid. I can see the corrected records. You can see CA and WA were corrected to California and Washington.
Did what we told it to do.
And here are the ones that were valid and what their values were. Beautiful. Pretty cool, huh?
Beautiful.
All right. So headed back to the slides, we have next.
Validating data with SSIS. So, I have to let you tell the story.
No, please.
Well, rather than having such a manual process of validating data, maybe we want to raise the bar a bit.
Automate it.
Automate.
Because as good DBAs, I want to have all the things that happen repetitively be automated and take all of that manual labor out of the process. So I've got validating tools using a data source, a data cleansing project, and then a data cleansing transform, which can take and do the exact same thing that I just did manually. You need to have data destinations to hold the cleansed data, and you need to, and you can also pipe it through other transformations after the fact. Now, SSIS is the best place to do this because now, as you're pulling your data from point A to point B, from source systems through into destination systems, you can do the cleansing in transit and end up with clean data with no manual intervention. You like that?
I do, and it looks like you have something to show here.
We are going to give this one a shot. Let's head on over, and I have a knowledge base. I have a cleansing project, so I am going to close out of my
DQS
client. And now we are going to create, come on, where, I'm not at the top, that's why.
Your mouse by the Hyper-V buttons has made my hair stand up on end a couple of times.
Yeah.
If you power those down.
Yeah, I've kind of noticed I haven't clicked very often.
You have. You've been very careful.
I got to tell you, I am the king of closing windows accidentally. I am absolutely flabbergasted that I have not closed that Hyper-V window once all day. All right, so let's go back to the virtual machine here. We're going to do a new project. It's going to be an integration services project. And very simply, what I want to do is show you that DQS transform. So I'm going to drop a data flow task onto our designer.
Star of the opera.
Yep. And then we're going to come over here and we are going to go to DQS cleansing and drop it in place. Now, first thing is it has no available input columns. So guess what I need to do?
That means it's a source.
I need to go and grab some data to put into it. So I am going to create a source, a data source, that is going to be an OLED. Yeah, I'm going to grab a data source. So what do? I grab a destination. I'm going to grab an OLEDB source. We're going to configure that source up. We're going to grab a new connection manager that's going to go out to our demo DQS. And we are going to grab... All right, let's create a new connection manager. Now, it didn't like the one that I just got. So I'm going to create a new one that's going to go out to... I clicked on the arrow. I haven't done that all day either.
Not once.
No, but now we can wait for that to happen.
And you know what? I misspoke. The DQS is a transform, so it's going to have inputs.
It is, yep. So I'm going to go out to MIA-SQLBI. I'm going to go out and I'm going to grab data from demo DQS. Ah, that's why I missed a... I did not run a script that I need to run. So my demo DQ database isn't in there. So we're going to go back out real quick to Management Studio. We are going to run a script that's out there that's going to create it. I need to go out and grab from mod 9. There's my
setup
script. Yep. And there's my demo DQS. We'll execute it. Now I've got my data. So I should be able to go back in. Sorry about that, folks. We are going to go back in. We now have in here, or we should anyway. I'm going to cancel it out. I'm going to choose my demo DQS.
Perfect.
There's my stores table. I go to columns. It grabs the columns in the store table. We now have our data source that we're going to put through the cleansing.
Perfect.
I connect the two. Now I go to my DQS cleansing. The first thing it needs to know is the data quality connection manager. I don't have one, so I'm going to define a new one. It says, where is your DQS server? I'm going to point it to the one I've got on SQL BI. We test it. We got the right one.
That's good.
We're good to go. Now, what knowledge base are we going to use?
Well, we only have one right now. So
that's a good thing. We'll do our DQS data. These are our available domains. Now I'm going to set up my mapping. My available input columns, I'm going to choose my state. The domain that it's going to map to is US state. I now have my mapping set up. I can save my component. At least I can once I get to where the save button is. There's my OK.
Perfect.
And now I can take that output and put it somewhere. We're going to create a flat file destination real quick.
Oh, that was a source.
Huh. I'm just all over it today, aren't I? There's my
just
destinations.
Trying to cover.
Flat file destination. We're going to hook the two up. Define the output. So I'm going to create my connection manager. It is delimited. It is going to go to the desktop.
Excitement's building.
It is. I'm getting there slowly but surely. We give it a file name, which is going to be cleansed stores.
Nice.
Dot out. Dot text. I hit open. Now, and that destination could be a SQL Server destination to populate a table if I want it to. Here are all my columns. Notice the store ID, the name, street, city, state. I've got state source, state out, state status,
red upstream,
record status. Everything is there. Now, I do my mappings. That ties it all together. When I execute the package, it reads the data from the table, runs it through the cleansing output. Come on, folks, I know you got it. There we go. It goes through the cleansing. When the cleansing has completed, it goes out to the flat file destination where it gets written. This is taking way too long.
It's working. It's working.
If I could put more horsepower on this virtual machine, folks, trust me, I'd put it on there. But at this point, we can only wait.
Sure.
There we go. We have success.
Lift off.
Now, I go out to my desktop. There is Cleanse Stores. And you can see, store one, New York, New York, New York, it's correct. California, California, WA, Washington is corrected. And it says it out at the end as well. So again, that transform gives you the fully corrected data, and you can take it. You doing a transform later on, use those corrected values to load downstream data destinations.
All right, everybody take a deep breath and exhale.
Enterprise data. Woo.
We looked at master data services, data quality services, a whole bunch of things today. And now it's time for a survey. You'll see a poll down at the very bottom of your screen. A lot of resources went into making this available today. And they're interested, the powers that be, in getting your feedback. So please,
as are we, quite honestly.
We are too, sure. We want to make sure that it was worthwhile for you. And so please take the survey at the bottom. And on behalf of Rich Curry and myself, George Squillace, thank you for attending. And we hope to have you come back for some of the other jump starts that are that will be available.
Absolutely. Keep your eyes out on MVA. Thanks, folks. Have a great rest of the day wherever you may be.